Welcome to the lunch break. It is Friday of Passion Week, such a busy day in the life of Jesus. Last night about 1 a.m, Judas Iscariot dropped into the Garden of Gethsemane, gave the royal kiss of love to Jesus on the cheek, and the soldiers led Jesus away for about 8 hours of trumped up charges, false accusations, and a pitiful trial, which according to religious frenzy, they chose Jesus over a murderer named Barabbas. And therefore, Pilate the governor said, "What do you want me to do with this guy, the king of the Jews you call Jesus?" And they said, "Well, let's just crucify him." And then thus the story of the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. He's beaten beyond recognition according to the prophet Isaiah. And they lead him up on a hill called Golgotha, and they crucify him and impale him on a stick. And Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the King of the Jews, is dead. What a tragic day. But I want to give you about 4 scriptures to think about today that hopefully will open your eyes and challenge you into this time of maybe what is a great lesson that we, 2,000 years removed from that moment, can get out of this. Let's jump right in. Mark chapter 15, verse 16 through 20. So just 4 verses. Here we go. The soldiers took Jesus into the courtyard of the governor's headquarters, called the Praetorium, and called out to the entire regiment. They dressed him in a purple robe, and they wove thorn branches into a crown and put it on his head. Then they saluted him and taunted, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they struck him on the head with a reed, spit on him, and dropped to their knees in mock worship. When they were finally tired of mocking him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him again, and then they led him away to be crucified. That's a pretty powerful statement, but I think it speaks a lot, even though it's 2,000 years ago, to modern day religious Christianity. How so? Because the typical is we come to this religious service once a week called church. And in that moment of church, we put the royal robes on Jesus. We crown him Lord of all. We sing, "Hail Jesus, King of the Jews, Lord of all, Savior of my soul." We read some passage of scripture. We give an offering. And we honor him as the royalty and the deity of who he is. But once the service is over and I'm tired, I walk out of the worship and I take the royal robes of his divinity off and I put the common clothes back on him and I go about my life. In other words, I only declare him as divine once a week in this ceremony called church. And then I put the ordinary clothes back on him. And I just never change. Oh, I love him. I go through the ritual. I say the right words and sing the right songs and give the right offerings. But when I'm tired and I've given him my hour, well, I just remove the purple clothes off of him and he ceases to be Lord of all. He ceases to be the king of my life. He ceases to be the savior of my soul. And I go about my day treating him as a common man. I go about my week just treating him as a friend, occasionally thinking about him and sometimes maybe even talking to him, but he's not Lord. Why? Because I left his divine clothes back in this religious service called church, and the Jesus that I commune with is the common Jesus. He's my friend. He's the Jesus that tolerates me. He's the Jesus that expects nothing of me. He's the Jesus that lets me live just like I am with no expectations at all because he's my buddy. Because I've removed his royal robes and I've made him a commoner like me. Because if I can keep Jesus a commoner like myself, I don't have to change. And the way I ease my guilty conscience is once a week I come to this thing called church, crown him Lord of all, say, "Hail Jesus, King of the Jews," use my religious words, hallelujah, amen, and praise the Lord, give him my worship. Oh, and then when I'm tired, like the Roman soldiers, I just simply strip the divinity off of him, put his common clothes back on, and Jesus and I get back in my car, and for the rest of the week, it's me and my buddy Jesus. With no expectation at all of his divinity, no expectation that I would change, no expectation that I would repent, and no expectation that he really is Lord of all and he controls every part of my being and my life. That's what I want you to think about today. It's not very inspiring, but it does challenge us all who call ourselves believers. Are we only believers through a mock service called church? while we give him our worship and while we say the right words and sing the right hymns and bring the right offerings. But when we're tired, we simply leave the building, remove his divine clothes, and go about our religious life with Jesus as a common man. I leave you to think about that today. As you go into the weekend, we go into the weekend celebrating Resurrection Sunday. It is an important moment in the history of Christianity because it will, according to Romans chapter 1, declare Jesus as the divine Son of God. I hope you have a great weekend. See me back next week, Monday, to kick off the lunch break next week. We're going to be talking about the week after the resurrection and what does it look like for us who call ourselves believers. As always, I'm keeping you in my prayer. I have you in my heart. I'm lifting you up before Jesus. Hey, go be the light of the world, the salt of the earth. Own your 50 feet for the kingdom of God. We can make a difference.